Study Arata. You have probably heard some advice against memorization. Teachers often recommend avoiding memorization and embracing understanding instead. But isn't learning things by heart something important in a learning process? Many times, memorization is essential to learn a new subject or topic. Of course, memorization is important because repeating information just like a parrot without understanding what you're saying is not really going to be useful in your life. But there are cases when you can't escape the good old rote learning. And students memorize information because they know it will be useful at certain points, especially to pass exams and tests. Therefore, memorization is important. But how is it part of the long-term learning process? In order to answer that, we need to get to the bottom of it and understand how memory works. We have a different content in today's episode of Study Arata, with several technical terms from neuroscience. So please pay attention in the way we will present each concept, and we will be understanding each one of them thanks to some examples, and at the final conclusion we will be doing repetition to anchor the understanding of all these concepts to our brains. And thanks to the different types of memory, you will only remember what is important. Today we'll see that there are different types of memory: sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. And to know the differences among these types of memory, just remember what you have done in the past 24 hours. Even if you haven't had a busy day, your brain will surely have taken more information than what you are able to remember. You're even able to remember some of the many things that happened yesterday, but you won't be able to recall all the specific details, the small things you have seen or heard or felt or smelled or tasted in the last 24 hours. What does that mean? What causes some information to remain in your memory and some other details to be ignored by your brain? There isn't a simple answer to this question, and both scientists and researchers have been trying for years to discover what makes some information relevant enough to be stored in our memory. And one of the theories is the information processing model. The information processing model suggests that our brain works like a computer. One of the most important suggestions about how our brain works is the information processing model. And this model suggests that our brain works similarly to a computer. It receives information from the outside, it processes the information, and provides decisions based on the processed information. The things you have just seen are in your short-term REM memory. If it is something irrelevant, then it will be stored in your long-term hard drive memory. The idea of a brain being like a computer that can be programmed was very successful, but it has a few limits. If you already know something about neuro-linguistic programming, you should know that our brain is not as simple to program as a computer. And even then, the comparison with the computer will help us to understand a little bit about how the brain works in general. This comparison works with three types of memory: sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. Let's see now how each one of these three types of memory will be working. Sensory memory is activated when one of your five senses registers new information. Think again about the things that have happened in the last 24 hours. Every time something happened, your brain received a signal. And when it receives information, your brain activates what we call sensory memory. Sensory is related to something linked to our senses, especially to vision and hearing, but also to the senses of smell, touch, and taste. And using the analogy of the computer, this would be when you type something on your computer, when you click somewhere, or when you give some command for the computer to execute. Sensory memory is the first contact that your brain has with the information from the outside. The thing is that there are thousands of things happening in your surroundings. Your ears are picking all types of noise. Your eyes might be focused somewhere, but your peripheral vision is also seeing many other things. Your nose is picking up different smells. Different parts of your body are in contact with your clothes, with the floor, with other objects that are also touching all of that. And even if you're not eating anything, your mouth is also sensing something. Your brain is not able to memorize all of this, otherwise it would be overwhelmed. Most of these details are not important, so they're discarded. This is why you can think about your sensory memory as if it would be a temporary record of all the information that your five senses deliver to your brain, especially the senses of sight and hearing. Depending on how the information is received, this sensory memory can be unfolded into three different types of sensory memory. Sensory memory is divided into three types: iconic, echoic, and haptic. Now don't worry, subdivisions of sensory memory have seemingly difficult names, but the concepts are very easy. The iconic sensory memory is linked to what you see. You just have to remember the icons on your phone, on your computer. Echoic memory is linked to what you can hear. You can think about the word echo, and then you can quickly connect the word echoic to the sense of hearing. And then haptic memory, the sensory memory, haptic sensory memory, is linked to the rest of the senses, especially to touch. Haptic memory is the least studied one, so we're now going to be focusing on the iconic and echoic sensory memories. Everything you see is temporarily registered in the iconic sensory memory, and everything you hear is temporarily registered in the echoic sensory memory. But how long does temporarily mean? Well, it depends. The information you're seeing will last less than half a second. The information you hear will last a bit longer, around 3 or 4 seconds. Sensory memory lasts so little in order to not be overwhelming your brain. Just the most important information will be memorized for a longer period of time. But how does the brain decide what to focus on so then it can remember? This is when the second type of memory comes in. This is the short-term memory. Short-term memory separates the potentially important information from all the rest. That is why it is also our working memory. Our brain receives a lot of information through our 5 senses, and this information is temporarily registered in our sensory memory, and almost all of it will be forgotten. We will now see what happens with information that is not immediately forgotten, and here is where you can find some of the details that you will remember from the last 24 hours. The information your brain considers important travels from the sensory memory to the short-term memory, also known as working memory. If you research about it, you'll probably find sources that differentiate working memory from short-term memory, but since there are so many similar functions, here we will be introducing them both at the same time. And unlike sensory memory, short-term memory is not defined by how long we remember something. Short-term memory is defined about how much information we are able to remember and manipulate at a given time. This quantity revolves around the number 7, with a margin of 2 more, 2 less. And this means that, thanks to short-term memory, you're able to store from 5 to 9 bits of information at one given time, and that is why the first telephone numbers were approximately 7 digits long. That's the quantity that a regular person is able to recall quite easily. Short-term memory has 2 support systems, the visual spatial system and the auditory rehearsal system. Both support systems are coordinated by a central executive system. Depending on the type of information you receive, short-term memory uses a support system, visual, spatial, or auditory rehearsal. Let me explain that. If you receive information by way of a photograph, a chart, or a map, this information will be stored in the visual spatial storage. This is the system that handles visual spatial information. But if you receive something verbal, like numbers or words, that information will be processed by an auditory rehearsal filter. Do you know when you keep repeating something so that you don't forget? Well, this is the auditory rehearsal cycle in action. You received some information verbally, now you're repeating it just so that you don't forget it. When you repeat something, your brain is receiving the same information over and over again. This is a cycle style. You get it? So, if you see something, it is something visual, you're using the visual spatial storage. If you hear something, you will be using the auditory rehearsal cycle. But what if you watch a video with both images and sounds? Or what if you are in the middle of a class and you're seeing your professor write something on the blackboard? That is visual information, but you're also listening to the explanation with sound information. In order to process mixed information like this, your brain needs to coordinate the information, and to do that, your short-term memory adds a central executive system. The central executive system supervises the integration of visual and verbal information, coordinating both support systems. Long-term memory is the final stage. You can only remember the truly important information. You can think about the memorization process as if it were a funnel with a filter. The mouth of the funnel, the longest part, is where all the information from our 5 senses comes in. The middle of the funnel, the short-term memory, stores a small quantity of that information that might be important. And at the end of the funnel, where the end of the filter is, this is the long-term memory that only remembers the truly important information. If something makes it to the long-term memory, one way or the other, it means that your brain thought it was important. That is why you're able to forget something that happened in the last 24 hours, and at the same time, you're also able to recall something that happened when you were a little child. The meaning of long-term is a little bit relative. Visual sensory memory lasts for around half a second. So compared to that, something that you remember a few days from now might be considered long-term. For this reason, psychologists say that long-term memory can last for a few days to many years. And unfortunately, long-term memory is not as infallible as we would like. Sometimes we forget something that we think is important, but for some reason our brain didn't consider it to be important enough, so it discarded the memory. Nevertheless, we're still able to remember a great amount of information in our long-term memory. The details stored in our long-term memory are split into two categories: explicit information and implicit information. The explicit information in a long-term memory is the one that you're able to remember and describe with clarity. The explicit information in a long-term memory are those memories that you're able to describe and state with clarity, explicitly. That is why they're also called declarative information. For example, a birthday party that you had when you were little. That event might have been so remarkable that after so many years, you're still able to describe clearly that party, even today. Long-term memory, in the explicit category, is divided into two subcategories, semantic and episodic memory. Semantic memory is linked to words. I'll give you an example. When you're doing a test and you're trying to remember descriptive names, like the capital cities of different countries, then you're using semantic memory. Episodic memory is related to events. Whenever you remember an event that happened in the past, like that birthday party, now you're using episodic memory. So explicit information in the long-term memory is quite easy to understand. Now, the implicit information is a little bit more complicated. Implicit information in the long-term memory is the one that you're not able to describe with clarity. But even so, you still remember. The implicit information in the long-term memory is also called non-declarative. They're named like that because you're not able to exactly explain, to declare, to describe how you remember that information. Nevertheless, you remember. It's like saying that you got a bad grade in the exam because you didn't know how to answer the question, but you swear you knew about the topic. Maybe you actually knew, but in an implicit way, not explicitly. Implicit information in the long-term memory is also divided into two subcategories: procedural memory and priming memory. Procedural memory is linked to performing a specific procedure. For example, let's say that you know how to drive a car. So you went to the driving school, you received information from the instructor, and you figured out how to carry out some different procedures like pressing the gas pedal and using the brakes and shifting gears. And you learned how to drive. You might be not able to exactly explain how you do it, how you drive, but you have the knowledge, even though you can't explain it. You know it implicitly. Priming memory is pre-activated by a sensory stimulus like a sound, image, smell, or a word. In a priming memory, your past experiences influence the current interpretation that you have about a particular event. I'll give you an example. Imagine someone recently watched the Incredible Hulk. And then in a casual conversation, someone else asks who was their favorite superhero when they were little. The answer of that person might be the Incredible Hulk. But if that same person would have recently watched a Batman movie, maybe the answer might be Batman. This happens because the most recent events can influence our long-term memory. In this way, priming memory is linked to the influence that a prime event has over a later event, called the target event. The marketing companies often use the priming technique to induce certain ideas that may cause you to buy something. And how is your memory doing? Do you remember everything I've said so far? I have said around 2,000 words so far. Are you able to remember every single one of them? You obviously can't remember every single word I said. It is not necessary either. What you need is to understand how our brain remembers some of the information it receives and the three types of memories that exist. Now, imagine you were to take an exam about the types of memory and their subdivisions. In that case, it would be important for you to remember that there are three types of memory: sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. Sensory memory registers the stimuli that we receive through our five senses, but for a short time. It is divided into iconic sensory memory, which is connected to what we see, echoic memory, linked to what we hear, and haptic, linked to the rest of the senses. Short-term memory is able to retain a certain amount of data. That quantity is about 7. Short-term memory is divided into two support systems, visual spatial and auditory rehearsal cycle. These support systems are coordinated by a central executive system. And lastly, long-term memory retains the information that our brain considers to be important. These memories can last from several days to several years. Long-term memory is split into explicit and implicit memories. Explicit memories are those that you can describe, whether they are linked to names or specific events. Implicit memories are the ones that you can't describe with clarity, but they are the ones you still remember. Implicit memories are divided into procedural memory and primary memory. Do you know why I keep repeating all that information? Because repetition is one of the best ways to remember everything you've learned here. If you needed to memorize everything you've learned here for an exam, repetition would be one of the best ways to do it. Memorizing information is often relegated to a second place during a learning process, but memorization has its place, and it is often more important than comprehension depending on your specific goal. The best thing would be, obviously, to be combining both techniques. You have to memorize whatever you need to remember and comprehend what you need to understand. And in order for you to do this in a systematic and integrated way, I'd like to invite you to see our course, Intelligence Arata Academy. You can learn more by accessing arata.se/intelligence.